amazing. Thank you, Scott. Best gift that ever happened, having you do his life sketch. And thank you, Heber. And Pat loved Cowboy Songs, no doubt about that. Well, I'm going to do a three-part talk today. I'm going to talk about the lessons I learned from my dad. I'm going to talk about the lessons that were most important to my dad. And I'm going to talk about what lessons he would want you to know today. So the lessons I learned from my dad. There's 100. I'm only going to give the top 10. Number one, it's not the size of the dog in the fight. It's the size of the fight in the dog. I wasn't the biggest kid for my age. And he never let that be an excuse. He taught me that if the other guy was bigger, you hit him first and you run. You hit him first and you make it count, but you never back down. Number two, the love of the mountains, hunting, camping. Love of the outdoors. We had the opportunity to live in a lot of different places, from Nevada to Montana, Nebraska, all over Idaho, and wherever we were, we made sure that we found time to be in the mountains and go camping and do the things that we love. So I learned a love of the mountains. Number three, Scott already talked about this, but love of skiing. I love, I'm still a ski freak and love to ski, and I learned that from my dad. Number four, Scott talked about this as well, to work hard. Get up early every day. I certainly can say I never claimed to be the smartest guy, but I can tell you I could work out, outwork anybody. That was my dad's sort of way he was, and I learned that from him. Number five, do it right the first time. I can't tell you how many fence posts I redug, how many haystacks I restacked because they weren't done just right. If anybody else did it, it was fine. But if it was one of his kids, we restacked them and we redug them. Number six, to dream big. That I could be and I could do anything in life that I wanted to do. I could be whatever I wanted to be. Number seven, expect success and believe in those dreams. Having a positive attitude. Favorite poem of his that I've had for years and years, as I was going through his journal this week, I found it in his own handwriting. It says this: if you think you are beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you like to win, but you think you can't, it's almost certain you won't. If you think you'll lose, you're lost. For out in the world we find, success begins with a fellow's will. It's all in a state of mind. If you think you're outclassed, you are. You've got to think high to rise. You've got to be sure of yourself before you can ever win the prize. Life's battles don't always go to the stronger or faster man, but sooner or later, the man who wins is the man who thinks he can. I can't tell you how many times I heard my dad share that poem, and I've shared it with my sons, and I think it's on a little plaque in one of my grandson's rooms right now. Number eight, serve others. I borrowed a book from my dad in 1980, 40 years ago. I meant to return it. It was called See You at the Top. Written by Zig Ziglar, and he would read out of this book, and I always said, Dad, I'll give it back to you, and he always told me I could keep it. I have never marked up anything in it because it's all in his own markings, but there was a thing, one of the things that he always taught was that our actions and deeds affect other people, many of whom we will never know. That's the reason our obligation and responsibility for doing the best we can with what we have goes way beyond our personal lives. Regardless of your field of endeavor, you can get anything you want in life if you help enough other people get what they want. My dad would always tell me that, Ron, you can get anything in life you want if you serve other people. So he taught me to serve people. Number nine, again, back in 1980, 40 years ago, I learned from my dad to have a personal board of directors. He had his own personal board of directors, people that were meaningful, important in his life that he could turn to and look to. And in 1980, I created my own personal board of directors. And over the course of time, I fired a few board members, and I've brought a few board members on. But my dad was the very first on that list in 1980, and through the good and the bad for 40 years, he never got fired. He's still there, but he'll always be there. Yeah, number 10, my dad taught me to do what's right. He wrote me a letter in spring of my senior year, big long letter. This was in March of 1977. And at the very end of it, he closed it with this: "Be honest, trustworthy, and virtuous in all things, and you will work miracles in your own life and also your friends. Stand for what you know is right. Dare to be right. Dare to be true. Dare to be different. Learn now to keep the commandments of God and to serve Him always before all else. You are His son, and He loves you even more than I, if that were possible." So from my dad, I learned to, and even when dad, he would always tell me this: "Now, Ron, I'm not making the best choices right now, but that doesn't give you an excuse. You know better. I know better, but you know better. Always choose the right." So those are things, a handful of things my dad taught me. So what are some of the lessons that were most important to my dad? It's like Scott, I've read a lot of his different writings this week, and one of them I found this. Called Things I Believe In, and I'm not going to read all these, but he listed these in numerical order. He said, number one, the sun will always shine again. Number two, God created this world and everything in it. Number three, I believe in the seasons of the year. Number four, things can be better than they are. Number five, God loves little children. Number six, God loves all His children. Number seven, we are all God's children. So number eight, therefore God loves us. Number nine, I believe in my family. Number 10, God will do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Number 11, every problem has a solution. Next, for every seed of adversity, there is an equal or greater seed of benefit. And finally, this life is a place of growing day by day, and no matter where we are, what we've been through, or what we've done, we still have a purpose in life, something special God has for us to do. In addition to those things, in his later years, there were four principles that made a great deal of my dad. The four principles are, number one, forgiveness. Seeking forgiveness from the Lord and forgiving others. Just as the Savior pleaded with the people anciently, He pleads with us today, found in Matthew, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." In addition to seeking forgiveness for our own sins, we must be willing to forgive others. Dad always taught that everyday circumstances in life, you'll surely be wronged by other people, sometimes innocently, sometimes intentionally. It's easy to become bitter and angry, vengeful in such situations, but the Savior counseled, "Love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." Dad believed in the power of forgiveness. Second principle is hope. The world sometimes misunderstands the word hope. In everyday language, the word hope has a hint of uncertainty. For example, we may say we hope for a change in the weather, or we hope for a visit from a friend. But in the language of the gospel, the word hope is sure, unwavering, and active. Prophets speak of having a firm hope and a lively hope. When we have hope, we trust God's promises. We have quiet assurance that if we do the works of righteousness, we will receive our reward.
even peace in the world and eternal life in the world to come. Mormon taught that such hope comes only through the atonement of Jesus Christ. What is it that we shall hope for? Behold, I say to you that you shall hope through the atonement of Christ and the power of his resurrection to be raised into eternal life. And this because of your faith in him according to the promise. Dad believed in the importance of hope. The third principle is the plan of salvation. Part of Heavenly Father's plan is that someday we will all die. Death is the separation of the spirit and the physical body. Our spirit, which existed in the premortal life, will live on after our death. An understanding and a testimony of the plan of salvation can give hope and perspective as we experience the challenges, the trials, the triumphs of life. We can find comfort in the assurance that our Savior lives, and that through his atonement, he breaketh the bands of death, that the grave shall have no victory, and that the sting of death shall be swallowed up in the hopes of glory. Dad had a strong belief in the plan of salvation. The fourth principle is eternal families. Oh, how Dad loved his family. Scott's talked a lot about that. In the last few years, we talked many times about Dad's love for his family and how proud he was of his children and grandchildren. In fact, I would say the most common words that I've heard this week from everybody that I've talked to is, boy, Joe sure was proud of his family. Boy, Joe sure loved his family. Boy, Joe sure told me, for me, where everywhere in the world where you were traveling, I knew where you were because Joe would tell me where you were. Dad strongly believed that families can be together forever. And his greatest hope was that he would be willing to see his mother again. And that he will be able to see each one of us again. Well, I suspect there's a pretty good reunion that's happening this week. I can tell you there's been a pretty good reunion happening in Bloomington. My siblings and I have been together all week, and it's been a wonderful, wonderful time of happiness to reminisce and talk and share love of family. But I suspect Dad and his siblings, his parents, and our ancestors are celebrating this week as well. And Dad, it's great to have you. Oh, how he loved you. Thank you for being here. And to his many nieces and nephews who are here today, I can't tell you how much joy it brought Dad when you came to Bloomington to visit and to stop in and see him. Thank you for being here. Dad loved his family. Well, what lesson would Dad want you to know today? Well, it's the same principles that were important to him. The importance of forgiveness. The importance of hope. The importance of the plan of salvation. And the importance of family. What would be his advice if he were here right now? This is what he would say. Every day, show unconditional love, and every day, do something to serve others. If you want to honor my dad, live by the words of the hymn titled, Have I Done Any Good? Have I done any good in the world today? Have I helped anyone in need? Have I cheered up the sad and made someone feel glad? If not, I have failed indeed. Has anyone's burden been lighter today? Because I was willing to share. Have the sick and the weary been helped on their way? When they needed my help, was I there? There are chances for work all around just now, opportunities right in our way. Do not let them pass by, saying, sometimes I'll try, but go and do something today. 'Tis noble of man to work and to give, love's labor has merit alone. Only he who does something helps others to live. To God, each good work will be known. Then wake up and do something more than dream of your mansion above. Doing good is a pleasure, a joy beyond measure, a blessing of duty and love. If there's one song besides a cowboy song that reminds me of my dad, that's the song. Well, I started with a few lessons from my dad.
Now, just
say this, there has been no one in my life that has had a greater influence on my life. I am like him in so many ways, and sometimes I cuss him for that. Most of the time I celebrate him for that. My dad was truly one of my heroes. Dad, you were excited to see your dear mother and your siblings. Dad, I can't wait to be able to feel your warm embrace and see you someday. I hope to see you at the top. I want to just, again, thank everybody for being here. This means a lot to our family to see so many people here, family and friends, and we appreciate your love and support and what you've done, the good that you've done for our family this week. It's been a wonderful time. Celebration for our family, and we want you to know how much we love and appreciate you and what you've done for us. And I leave these things today in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.